and I would have won a couple Super Bowls and rode off into the sunset, I'd simply now just be like a 41-year-old asshole with two Super Bowl rings. That's who I'd be. And I don't want to be that guy, you know? So that's the best way I can do it. And when people screw up, we don't admonish them, and it's not punitive, right? This is a disease, and it can be treated as such. The war on drugs doesn't work. We've seen it. We've been trying to do it from the 80s. It doesn't work. You can't incarcerate your way out of this problem. Decriminalize, legalize, get answers and solutions. That's the best possible way I can think of making change. Portugal has a very good diagram for what that looks like if you ever have a chance to look at what Portugal does with the substance abuse and mental health issues. Yes, sir.
Another quarterback's been in the news lately. I was wondering if you reached out to him, Todd Marinovich. He has a heroin problem. I guess he got arrested twice in the last, in 4 days, a couple weeks ago. Have you been able to talk to him at all? He's in California.
Yeah, I have. My sponsor puts it this way. He said, once we find this acceptance and this surrender, we become a lighthouse of sorts, right? And you don't see lighthouses running around the harbor looking for boats. It's the other way around. So, of course, I reached out. I reached out to Johnny Manziel. I reached out to Todd Marinovich, and I offered my help. And that's all I can do. If they're not open and willing to accept that help, that's on them. That's the choices part, right? They can choose to deal with something in a healthy and positive way, and so far they've continued to choose not to, because once you've got sober once, you have the tools. That first use after that is all on you. What happens after that is your disease, of course, but I relapsed twice, so I've been through that. I learned about the tools that I can use, and I chose to take that first drink or that first drug. That's on me. You know, like I said, what happens after that is the disease, and then what we're seeing now is the consequences to him and that disease. So I continue to offer it, and everybody's on their own journey. You hope it happens before they die. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, thank you so much. I'm Kathleen, and I work here as the addiction counselor on our campus, so I'm really grateful that you're here. I just wanted to know from my own understanding, was there a history of addiction of some kind in your family? Maybe not alcohol or drugs, but some sort of a threat.
Apparently my grandfather was an alcoholic. I never saw it, but it was my mom's father. And she told me about it and what she grew up watching. And when she started seeing her son exhibit those same behaviors, she tried to protect me and keep me safe from everybody's judgment and scrutiny when I was younger. So I think that had a contribution to enabling that behavior, because she saw it. I mean, she was the oldest of five daughters, and she had to protect her mother from the alcoholic father, and she saw those same behaviors in me and immediately tried to do the same thing. And she understands that. She's my biggest champion, and she's gone to Al-Anon, and she's learned how to deal with the addict, which didn't necessarily exist back when she was dealing with her father at that time. So things changed. So yeah, there's a genetic history to that. There has to be. And we know it is, because it's a science. Yes, sir.
So now that you're off parole, I'm assuming, right?
No, I still have a year left.
Oh, all right. So I'll ask a different question then.
Why? What was the question if I was? Because I asked the question too.
I was gonna ask, without the threat of jail over your head, but at the same time to send you back, what kind of advice do you follow that you use to help you resist the temptations that trigger you, but it wouldn't matter?
I think that even if I weren't on parole, that still exists. You know, I know what happens with me. I even had the idea that I just had my six year sober on April 1st, and I feel weird when you clap for that. I just do, because there's a lot of people who can, never mind. All right, so people ask all the time, can you go have a beer? And I'm like, well, it wasn't necessarily an issue with me. That drug's been out of my system for a long time. Maybe the boys wanted to go have a beer, watch the ball game, that'd be okay. I combine everything now and understand that everything's a mood-altering substance for me. And for a lot of people, if I were to go have beers with the boys, it'd be because I didn't either feel comfortable with myself in that moment or not comfortable with the people I was around. Usually it was being in public, and I knew people were looking at me, and I had to alter my mood so I didn't feel all that. And that's what I would be doing. So I'm staying from everything now. I've added healthy alternatives like exercise and hiking and meditation and things like that. So there's healthy alternatives. And I don't have this figured out, like I said. It's the cool thing about this is being a former athlete is that my life's regimented and my life's a maintenance program now. I have to continue to do this stuff on a daily basis or, you know, I take a drink of alcohol and I break out in handcuffs. That's what happens to me. I'm different when it comes to substances. I can't do it the right way. Because I don't walk into a room and go and hear somebody who goes out and has a beer at night. I don't go and say, hey, that's a terrible person. You know, I can't do that. So I tell you my story and hopefully develop some self-awareness as a group that you understand why you're doing something, because there's always a reason why you're doing something. Usually in college, I talk to them about why are you going out every Thursday night when you have a big game Friday or a test on Friday and binge drinking with your friends. I mean, there's going to be a consequence. There's nothing wrong with doing it, but you understand that there's a consequence, and if you continue to do it over and over again, then you have to take a look at something. That's always the issue. Being on parole is actually, there's an accountability piece there. You know, he shows up every other month, drug tests me. I have to confirm with him every time I want to leave and go somewhere for permission. I mean, if you're doing the right thing, it's not a hassle. So it doesn't necessarily it just adds a little more accountability. When that ends, it'll be a good question to ask. What am I doing to kind of replace that? Maybe I take a couple of my friends who are my accountability partners and ask them to do something similar. That would be probably the best answer I could give for that. So,
can I ask one more?
Yeah.
Real quick. So a few hours ago, Senator Bernie Sanders, he proposed a bill that would condemn all the executives behind the opioid epidemic. So considering your platform and all the influence you have and the presence you have in America, how would you feel about that bill being passed? I mean, do you think they should be held accountable for the billions they've made off of the misery they caused?
Yeah, I mean, I think there should be accountability. There's accountability for everybody for who does anything. And, you know, Purdue Pharmaceutical was a major player in all of that. They've offered up. Now, they have so much money. Throwing money at it doesn't necessarily do anything for me. The biggest thing that I saw recently was their rollback of a lot of their lobbyists and their sales force division. That shows that they're not out there pumping it. So for me, that was a semblance of that. I don't necessarily know if we're ever going to be able to hold these organizations accountable. And sometimes for me, I work with this new sports psychologist who works with Russell Wilson. His name is Trevor Moen, and he works with college football a lot, and he's helped me a ton in the art of positive thinking. I don't mean like thinking positive. He's about not thinking negative. Just removing the negative process. Even thinking positive doesn't necessarily change that, but if you don't think about the negative side, so almost I find a way to find solutions rather than think about the negative things that people have done. I almost feel like that is a waste of my time because I necessarily can't affect change there. Somebody like Bernie may be able to. I can't. What I can do is walk into maybe a convention that Purdue's putting on, tell them my story and show how the impact it had on me, because I know no other drug than hydrocodone given to me by a doctor that ultimately took me to a place where I was, if a doctor at the time told me, hey, these pills are for your pain, but the side effect could be breaking into houses 20 years later and going to prison for 3 years. I mean, there would be a significant change in my thought process in whether I took those pills or not. It would, but that's not how it's gonna be told to you, right? So there's some accountability there. That's the position I would take, and probably that. I would, of course, you know, stand behind this bill. I think a lot of Senator Sanders when it comes to what he does and what he believes in. So that's something I would look at and I probably need to know more about. So let's do two more. Yeah.
A lot of teams have veteran players who are there supposed to be mentors to the younger players on the team. Like you guys with the Chargers, like Junior Seau. What was a piece of advice maybe that a veteran player offered you when you were a rookie that you wish you had taken on?
Well, Junior was one of them, you know. So after that Kansas City game, I really got pushed into a corner. I got the defensive nature of me would not allow, because I was surrounded by a bunch of guys. I had Rodney Harrison and Junior Salem. I would have just like literally put my nose like at the top of their butt crack and followed them around for 3 years and learned how to be a professional. That's who I should have been. Instead, I did something like this. John Carney, our kicker at the time, came to me. He had a friend who was close with Tony Robbins. I don't know if you guys know who Tony Robbins is. Of course, he's the philanthropist, entrepreneur, and unbelievable motivational speaker. And Tony had offered me an opportunity to come to his private island on Fiji and go through some self-help work with him for a weekend. And I think my exact words to John at the time was, fuck Tony Robbins. That was my mindset, so I didn't see it then, right? Now, to turn this thing over twofold, Junior Seau, at the end of his career, developed CTE symptoms and wasn't able to do the same thing, wasn't able to ask for help, telling people he struggled. Instead, he felt it was necessary to take his own life. That was his only way out. I can't imagine his impact he would have. His story and his impact would be even more important than mine. And instead, he thought that was the only way out. So it's imperative that us who have experienced these things talk about it and offer the opportunity for people to do the same thing. So, one more.
Right here.
Go one more.
Hi, so recently Martellus Bennett came out about like the opioid problem in the NFL, the doctors are over-prescribing opioids. Do you feel like there should be alternatives to them being prescribed opioids, such as like the stem cells, marijuana, and such?
I'm an abstinence guy, so even though I've seen positive results from marijuana, I've also seen, by working in recovery, the delusional effect that marijuana use can affect people with. I'm also of the mindset that if you have to use a drug to do your job, then maybe it's time for you to find another job. That's just me, because I know there's a bunch of guys out there that their earning potential may only last 3 or 4 years where they can make millions and millions of dollars and provide for their family, and they're willing to do whatever that takes to do that. And I understand that. I also experienced life differently than others, and I know what's important now, and being a football player and making a bunch of money isn't even relatively close to the top of the list what I think is important for my life. So I'm always going to be the guy that, yes, opiates are overprescribed. I would walk on a plane after a game. On the one side of the aisle would be a cooler full of beer, and the other would be a doctor handing me a couple of Vicodin. That was our recovery program, Sunday nights, and then take a little Monday, start to wean off them on Tuesday, get ready to play by Sunday. That's the life. So that's what we did to play, to make the millions of dollars that were offered us. I don't believe you should replace it with another drug. That's just my opinion. I just don't believe that if you have to use a drug to do your job, then I would suggest finding another job. And that may not be a popular one for athletes trying to play, but you know, I don't want anybody ever to, you know, I know people who've done marijuana, have taken marijuana for years and become full-blown drug addicts, you know, so I wouldn't jeopardize my life just to do that for a couple more years to feel pain-free, because I've had 15 surgeries, I'm in pain, I don't take anything. I exercise and mobility training, I do physical therapy, I do fellowship, I work in service. I mean, your mind, training your mind will help train the body even more. I didn't believe that, I didn't think it was a science, and it's science, right? Because I shouldn't really be able to walk for how much I could be up. And, you know, I can do stuff in the gym like I could when I was 25 now, which is amazing. And it's just because of a different kind of work ethic and a better way that I approach stuff. So there's alternatives, there's healthy alternatives than just jumping right into bed with the idea of using a controlled substance or a drug to do that.